And then you meet Nelson Mandela in prison, Mr. Brown. Why did you apply to work at the prison?
During the apartheid, yes, all white children was forced for military training. One of my best friends died during the time in the military training, so I refused. I didn't want to go.
Yeah.
Look for alternatives. The best alternative at that time was become a prison warder.
And what were you told about Nelson Mandela? How did you perceive him?
When we arrived on the island after my training, they told us we're going to meet the biggest criminals in the history of South Africa. That first day when I opened the cell, I see elderly old man standing up from the floor, greet me very friendly and polite, "Goeiemôre, meneer." "Good morning, sir." So I was shocked to see such old people still in prison. Because where I grew up on a farm, my father said, respect elderly people, make no difference of the color of the skin. And here I met these old people, and they were humble, polite, and friendly to me.
Yeah, and then still, because you were supposed to guard him, and he was supposed to be your prisoner, how did you two wind up to get close and to get friendly towards each other? Because it's not what you expect of the relationship in the prison.
You know, it happened that I work in a sense office where I censoring the letters. And it also come that I one day booked a visit for Mandela from his wife, Winnie Mandela. Because all the visitors to the prison was black. He was not allowed to sit inside the boat. So they always protected with blankets and raincoats and things. It happened that she smuggled the baby to Robben Island. And where I get hold of this baby without her know, to show Mandela after he was begging us if you can show him the child.
So you showed Mandela his grandchild.
I showed him his grandchild. And then I could have not believed that day when he touched her and held her, there's tears in his eyes when he kissed her twice. And they could have seen this person was hungry for children. That was the things prisoners missed the most on Robben Island was children.
I see it still gets you. I see your eyes still get wet when you talk about it.
Yes, that was something very painful for me to see that children's been kept away from them.
How was it towards you? Did you talk about personal stuff as well?
You know, the first time we really was talking was when I take him to the visiting location. That day, he asked me, "Mr. Brandt, where you come from?" I tell him where I grow up on a farm. I stay in a city. He said, "That's good news. You can help me, give me advice in my prison garden." After that, he asked me, "Is your parents still alive?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Send him my greetings." And the next question after that, he asked me, "Mr. Brandt, are you studying?" I said, "No." He said, "You must make use of the time to study on Robben Island because that's the future of our country. You can become the head of this prison. You can become a future leader." And he was also pressurized me to study.
Could you say that you were guarding him and he was guiding you?
You know, that's correct.
Then there came this moment, because apartheid was a really a cruel system. Did he talk about apartheid with you, or didn't he talk about it at all?
You know, on Robben Island, he never talked about the apartheid system. But I asked him one day if he don't hate the white people of the country because of the oppression. And he looked at me, he said to Mr. Brandt, "I can't hate the white people of the country. I can hate the system which was in place, oppress one another, because my comrades are white." Then I found out people which were sentenced with him for life was also white people supporting him during the struggle.
He wasn't looking black and white. He was looking at people, of human beings.
That's correct.